Welcome to Midlife Matters. I'm Marie, and each week I'm joined by my friends Julie and Mindy to talk about all the topics keeping women in the middle years up at night. Today we're talking about avoiding burnout and staying sane during the holidays. Join us as we share pitfalls to avoid and explore what to embrace and what to let go. Let's get started. Listeners, it's only the beginning of November when we're recording this, but we're already gearing up for the holidays. And by the time we release this, we'll be heading full throttle into the Christmas season. So let's talk about staying sane during the most wonderful time of the year.
It's good.
And is there anything that gives more pressure than calling this the most wonderful time of the year?
Oh my goodness. It sounds like an oxymoron.
Yes. Yes. And listeners, I should say that we are joined again by Jennifer, who's been on several episodes this fall. Jennifer, welcome to Midlife
Hello.
Matters.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah. So Jennifer, do you feel pressure about this being the most wonderful time of the year, or do you just embrace it?
Oh, totally. I think everybody does. I think we, you know, as moms have this kind of picture in our mind of what we want it to be like and feel like and look like, and what the pictures when it's all said and done to look like. And so there's totally pressure that comes with the holidays. And we want to, I don't know. I mean, maybe I overthink it a lot, but I think I only have this limited number of years with my people and kids this way, you know, our little mm-hmm. family of five. And so you do want it to feel magical and all the things. But I think a few years in, when things start failing and flopping, you realize you got to let some of that junk go.
Right.
And then, you know, you embrace that as well. So, but I think there's always lingering things, and definitely entering different seasons of life bring on new pressures. And as I said last week, I have my oldest is a senior. And so that's just bringing about new things of what do we want our quote unquote last Christmas together to look like, even though it's not our last Christmas together,
mm-hmm.
but for sure.
Yes. Well, even though we're not there yet, imagine for a moment that you're coming off Thanksgiving and now you're heading into the Christmas season. And what are you feeling? Because we've all been around the block enough to pretty much know what we're going to be feeling after Thanksgiving.
Tired.
Yes.
Hopefully not panic.
Oh, true.
Yeah.
Like the first two things that run through my mind, okay, I'm going to make it three because I'm going to be a little extra here. I'm going to work on my sleep. I'm going to work out, and my food needs to get back in order. And I'm going to make it four. And I need some time alone. I'm going to like pull back myself and really try to like recover and also get ready.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like every single thing about the holidays is working against you succeeding at all four of those goals, Mindy.
Yes. Right. Yes. Because it's so dark at night. I'm tired by like 4:30. And I really need to be productive, and I could care less.
Mm-hmm. Those sound like January goals to me. Food, exercise, sleep. Oh. Those are January goals, not yeah. December.
Yeah, you can't meet those goals in December, Mindy. Give them up right now.
Yes.
I feel like mental health-wise, those are the things that I've learned I have to do.
Okay.
Yeah. That's good.
Yeah.
That's good. You know, even though we're recording this a little bit early, I think by the time this episode comes out, I will be in execution mode, like executing the plans, whatever the plans have been in place. We are now in execution mode. It's execution also sounds like death.
I know. But I thought you were going to say execution mode.
Maybe
it could go either way.
I'm executing my plans and dying to my dreams and visions of what they were supposed to be.
Yes.
But that's my word for where we're at.
Yes. All right. Well, as we head into the season, we know we're not going to completely avoid these feelings, but we do know that there are some pitfalls. We've all been around the block enough to know that there are some places that we fall down pretty consistently and that we can share with listeners pitfalls to avoid. And Mindy, why don't you start us off? Because I feel like your four goals are as a direct result of pitfalls that you've discovered along the way.
They are. And also becoming more self-aware of kind of what my mind needs, because I know at this point in life that a lot will be required of me in the hosting capacity. And I truly do love it. And I want to make sure now, more than food being right and house being perfect and beds being perfect, that it's okay for me to ask for help. That's taken a really long time, that I don't have to have everything done before people come. So that's one. Mm-hmm. That's one call, is I feel like I had this pressure for years that I had to have every single thing, every meal planned out and bought. Well, hello, Walmart delivers, mm-hmm. Instacart delivers. So we can kind of let that pressure die. Like, you can still buy food when people are at your house, and you can make decisions with them about what meal do you want that night. Oh, okay, we're just going to like order pizza. Mm-hmm. Don't feel like you have to have everything planned before people get there. Ask for help. Don't do it all yourself. One thing that I'm doing even today is I'm preparing my home for a lot of people. That means I'm changing up the seating in my house to allow for the gatherings. So my focus is more on gathering and a lot of seats together over how my house looks. Mm. I want the function to match the people over it being like beautiful, as close to magazine worthy as my house could be. So I even moved out, you know, some chairs, and I moved a couch in, and I'm like, I'm going to have three couches in the living room. Mm-hmm. This makes me so happy to have realized that I can just adjust my house and get through the season, because I want people to be comfortable. And then I'm trying to plan ahead. So this is another kind of like pitfall to avoid. While you don't have to have everything planned out, also don't procrastinate to the point of you're so stressed that you haven't thought about anything. And then people arrive and you're like, I just, you know, I had like lack of decision making, and I've put this off because I'm stressed about it and I don't want to make any decisions. You got to have a flexible plan in place before people come. And if, especially if you're hosting, I'm coming from the point of hosting. Mm-hmm. You got to have an idea of what you're going to do. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm.
I think for me, the pitfalls that I'm trying to avoid, like you said, are birthed because of the pitfalls that happened over the years. And I think, you know, when we moved to Tennessee almost, I think it's almost been 14 years. We had done Christmas a certain way for a couple of years, and then we moved. And then we, you know, once you move, the influx of visitors begins. And so then holidays took on a different shape of visitors. And then we went through a season of, oh, we're hosting. I don't love that. Like, I want to, you know, protect. I need to have boundaries. I started to learn boundaries. I wanted to protect maybe certain times around the holidays for just our family. And so then we, you know, and that, of course, is birthed out of like, well, that Christmas felt really stressful. So we're going to do that a little differently next year. And so each year was a little bit of learning. And I feel like the last couple of years, we've been in a really good rhythm. But now things are about to change because we have a senior. And so, like, I think it's having the awareness that, you know, every couple of years, your life stage shifts, and that comes with the holidays looking a little differently. And then acclimating to the shift comes from the pitfalls. And so you have to have a ton of grace for yourself, knowing that how you're going to shift is because of the flops and the failures that happened. I don't know if that mm-hmm. makes any sense. And,
oh, yes.
You know, like COVID for us, we were one of the millions of people that took up bread making in COVID. And that became like our new gift we would give for teachers. And we had never done that before. I used to do potpourri or, you know, whatever. Uh-huh. And then we were like, bread's a great gift. It feels very homey. And so we go to this local place and I get like a pair of, you know, olive oil and like cranberry apple vinegar. It's so good. And that has become like our gift for teachers. Well, that's a huge endeavor because mm-hmm. we want to serve it hot. And so my husband, you know, has to prepare it for a couple of days. Then we have to bake it the morning of. And so we have to map out who gets what loaves on which day, but it's become this thing that we've loved. But 3 years ago, this was not even on our radar, but now it's shifted into being this big thing that we do for our kids' teachers. But, you know, just planning ahead. So like the first 2 years that we did it, it was insane. And we were up at 3 a.m. and we were cranky and fighting and tired. And I'm like, crap, I don't have enough towels to wrap them up pretty. And oh, I ran out of rosemary to stick on the, you know, the little garnish as part of how I wrapped it up. And And so now heading into the holidays, I've learned, well, I have a really pretty tree outside. I can cut a branch off and that's my pretty garnish. I don't need a rosemary sprig, you know, and I've already bought my towels from Walmart and I know what size fits the best. And I go to the same rack now. So just and it, that comes from the failures of the years gone by. And so, I don't know. I just think, you know, when you start out with a young family, you just have all these beautiful, glorious expectations of how magical Christmas is going to be. And it just, you got to just dive right into the failures and realize everyone else is too. And, you know, when you go to your mom's house and everything's beautiful and everything's calm and peaceful, or your grandmother's house, or these women that have gone before us, it's because they failed for years and they learned along the way and they learned what things to let go and what things to hold fast to. And, you know, the bread for us has become something we really love to do. So we're going to continue for now to hold fast to that, but we're going to let go of, you know, X, Y, Z or whatever. So I don't know if that makes sense. I think for me, like you were asking the pitfalls, let me answer the question, is like the planning, I think, is to look back on the years before and say, well, that got crazy because of this. So I'm going to plan that ahead of time. And, you know, I know we're recording this early and I've already mapped out my kids' Christmas presents. You know, I've gotten the towels for the bread and I have my tree outside waiting to be cut up. And it's just planning, I think. It takes just a lot of pre-planning, and that planning happens in the fall. It's, you know, maybe in September, starting to like start processing and thinking through, what are my kids needing? What are they wanting? And start mapping that out. I was part of the, you know, the Pinterest era. They're like, my kids were right at the prime ripe age when that whole gift giving idea of something you want, something you need, something to wear, something to read. I don't know if you remember that or if y'all's kids were even the right age, but mine were the perfect age. And I totally latched onto that. And that has been a really nice boundary for our family for me to plan gifts. And I had seen, I saw this other one. It was, so it was something you want, something you need, something to wear, something to read, something to do, something for me, something for the family. And so that's like seven little sweet gifts, and that's my boundary. And so for me, it's become kind of fun, you know, in like September or October, that I've written it out in a note in my app, and I'm starting to map through, okay, something they need some underwear, something that they want, okay, they want Legos. And then it's like this game of shifting. That looks like that could be a me or a family. That could be a do or a want. And then it's like this little, it makes the gift giving kind of fun. So I don't know. I just think planning ahead, and the planning is birthed out of looking back on your past failures.
Right. From that. Right.
So that was a long answer to your question.
I love it, Jen. All this. Yes.
Yes. Well, I do think that the picture of you like fighting at 3 o'clock in the morning over the bread, that strikes a chord with me. And it kind of goes into one of the pitfalls I try to avoid, is trying to do all the traditions every year. You can't. I can't make Christmas cookies, go to visit Santa, go to the Santa parade, go to cut down my own tree, you know, do an Advent every week. Like, you just can't. I personally cannot keep up with all that. And I found that out by, I remember it was Christmas Eve, and my oldest son, he liked this cracker candy that I made. And I'm sure that I'd had many fails before this, but this fail sticks out in my mind. And it's Christmas Eve, and we're like a few hours from going to Christmas Eve service. And we should be at this point dialing back the stress and moving into maybe enjoyment mode. Every year I tell myself that on Christmas Eve afternoon, you should be dialing back now and moving into enjoyment mode. But that particular year, I still hadn't made the cracker candy, and Davis had asked me about it, and I had all the ingredients, I just hadn't made it. And of course, I was just struck with guilt that I had let go a tradition that, one, my son liked, because I don't know, in our family, the boys really don't speak up a lot about traditions. So if they bring one up, wow, that must be meaningful. I better be sure and do it. And I hadn't done it yet. And so then I started frantically trying to make it. And then I got all snappy with Steve because he's not being helpful in other areas. And the kids are still relatively young and I still need help. And there's five of them running around and I need to make this cracker candy because Davis wants this cracker candy. And he's not going to remember that I made cracker candy on Christmas if I don't do it this year. Like, it, you put so much pressure on yourself. And you get in a fight before Christmas Eve service, because you're trying to fulfill a tradition or an expectation. Meanwhile, you've also tried to fulfill 20 other expectations. You know, even if you have a bunch of kids, if every kid had two expectations and you tried to fulfill every one of them, I mean, there's 10 expectations for me just coming from my kids, let alone what I've maybe already put on myself or my mom wants me to do, or, you know, it's just a lot. So all that to say, women, I feel you, and you cannot do every tradition. Even this past Halloween, I have two granddaughters, and in my mind, before we go into fall, I think, okay, well, one Saturday we'll go to the pumpkin patch, and another Saturday we'll do a fall festival at a church, and another Saturday we'll do X, Y, or Z. We'll carve pumpkins. Okay, this year we did one festival, and it was in my neighborhood. And that was it. And did I get to the pumpkin farm right across the street from our neighborhood with them? No.
And that's okay.
One Saturday was all that fit in, because they also have their parents that want to do things with them for fall. And, you know, and then we trick-or-treated on Halloween. And so I had to pick in my mind, okay, well, what are the most important things? And that's kind of what I have to do at Christmas. I'm like, all right, who still likes Christmas cookie decorating? If nobody really makes a case for Christmas cookie decorating that year, then we don't need to do it. Mm-hmm. But if somebody really makes a case for another tradition, then I think, all right, well, let's do that one. Or is there something new that people want to try? But we have to pick and choose. We can't do all of them.
And I think, too, it's important to not be looking around at what everybody else is doing. Mm-hmm. That comparison, like, oh, it's thick and high at the holidays, because you're looking at so-and-so's beautiful, you know, Christmas cookies or their beautiful tree, and you're looking at your schleppy, you know, janky tree, or this person took all these gorgeous photos at the Christmas tree farm and they chopped down their own tree and all their buffalo check plaid and got the photos, and you're feeling terrible because it's the same plastic tree you've been putting up for 15 years. You've just, like you said, you've got to pick and choose. And I always laugh at this over the years, because I remember it was so important to me early on. Our first daughter was born, and so I was wanting to make this a tradition, and I had made Cuban food. And because I grew up in Tampa and Cuban culture is big there, and in my mind, we had Cuban food every year at Christmas. And we did. I can think back and look back in my mind of all these Cuban meals that we had on Christmas Day. And no one in my family is Cuban. It's just what we did. Mm-hmm. And so I had said to my mom something about how, oh, I'm making Cuban food. Can you give me that recipe? And she's like, why are you making Cuban food? And I said, because we, you know, that was our tradition in our house all growing up. And she goes, I didn't start that until you were in college. And I was like, really? No, you didn't. I totally had that all my whole life. And she said, no, I didn't start. And she would order it. She's like, I didn't start ordering Cuban food until you were in college. And in my mind, it was something that had happened for years and years. Mm-hmm. So it was like the things that we remember and grasp onto are not even real. They're just not even real. And so, you know, we think about what will our kids remember? Nothing. They won't. They won't remember. And right. So we've got to just let some of that go, you know, and maybe we have one thing that we do every year that they can latch. Maybe it's that crack thing you said. Mm-hmm. But then maybe if we have time, we take on a new one for that year alone. Mm-hmm. Maybe this particular year we do a pumpkin patch, but we're not going to commit ourselves year after year. Or this year we make cookies. Mm-hmm. Or this year, you know, but maybe there's one that happens every year, or two. But even then, there's room to let that go if need be and reevaluate how we're doing things.
Yeah.
Honestly, like traditions, if I'm not feeling it or if it stresses me out, I have had to determine that them having a happy, non-stressed mom is more important than the tradition. Mm. So unless they are willing to take charge and handle it, I'm going to tap out, because I know I want to be present mentally, physically, spiritually, emotionally for all of the dynamics that will be happening in my home. And that takes priority. But that has taken years for me to say, I would rather be happy for you, literally happy and joyful, than XYZ.
Right. All right. Well, listeners, those are a lot of pitfalls. And I'm sure you have even more. But hopefully we've covered some major ones. One of the pitfalls that we didn't even really directly address, but I do feel like can be a pitfall. You kind of addressed it, Mindy, by saying plan ahead. But what have you learned works for you over the years as far as cooking and serving food?
Okay, and this is born out of Bryce and I, our families are in two different states, and we have moved a lot. So I'm going to preface this with not everybody has this, you know, family dynamic. Also, when we had Nathan, when our fourth child was born, that's when everything kind of shifted. My parents got to an age, and my dad, like in his work life, he was more able to travel. He got more time off. He was doing civil service at the time. And so it changed from us going there or traveling anywhere to staying home, because we had four kids. We literally, it was a nightmare for us to try to travel. And it's not just a couple hours. It's like 14. Mm. And then it's like trying to, for them to host six people in their house, that didn't even make sense. Mm-hmm. So everyone started coming to my house when Nathan was a baby. He's 15 years old. I've been hosting at least that long. Mm-hmm. And it's Bryce's side at Thanksgiving and it's my side at Christmas is kind of how it just worked out. And yes, they're coming from a long, long ways away. So they're all staying. Years ago, I had to let go of, especially when the turkey didn't cook the one Thanksgiving. I have a nightmare story that happened when Nathan was like two that I've told before. And I sliced my finger open one year. I mean, I finally figured out last year what works for us. And let me tell you, this was beautiful. What works for us with food is that I have a flexible plan. I mentioned that earlier with avoiding pitfalls. I have somewhat of a plan, but I only provide, I'm only going to plan for like one meal a day. When it comes to like the Thanksgiving meal or the Christmas meal, I'm just going to include both holidays. What I do is I'll have the traditional Thanksgiving sides, just the pieces on hand. And last year, everyone loved it when I said, hey, you're in charge of this side dish. You're in charge of this side dish because everyone's in the house. Mm-hmm. Like, I might as well put them all to work. Well, it was so much fun. Everyone loved being in charge of their dish. And then it was almost like competitive, like, oh, who did a, you know, mm-hmm. the best job. And so it worked out for us. So it took it off of me. Mm-hmm. So I'm more about the people and the dynamics and let's just all get along. Mm-hmm. You know, that's my. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I'm kind of overseeing and I actually put myself out of the making something and let everyone else actually do the cooking. Mm-hmm. I'm hosting, I'm preparing, I'm doing the seating, I'm doing the table. Mm-hmm. And I can just flit in and out of whoever needs mm-hmm. something. But there are a lot of people that can be cooking. So I'm going to let them. Mm-hmm. And you can even assign cleanup duty to like younger kids that are old enough to clean up, but maybe not old enough that you would trust them with like a sweet potato casserole situation. Mm-hmm. So like my teenage boys are going to be like moving furniture to setting up tables, chairs, and then cleaning it all up, vacuuming dishes, the whole bit. Like they're doing all
that. That's great.
So that's the last thing I'm going to say about that.
So another thing I was thinking, because we do host a lot of out of town guests for, you know, several days at a time. And a lot of times with the holidays, like you were saying, Mindy, that is part of the holiday hosting process for a lot of people is having not just people over for the actual day and the meal, but then for several days surrounding that. And I think, you know, in years past of all the people we've hosted over the years, when it's multiple families, because Nathan comes from a big family and we've had them come up several times, it's nice to have a plan heading into the week of like, okay, breakfast, everybody is on their own for breakfast. And, you know, so maybe they do a little bit of grocery shopping, knowing what allergies or preferences are. It's hard on the host to accommodate all of those things for that many breakfast meals. And then lunches, just saying, hey, we've got lunch meat, we've got bread, we'll have fruit, we'll have veggies and dip. Like you can graze, you can do that, but that's what we're going to have prepared for lunch. And then dinners, you know, having a plan for dinners as, you know, as far as maybe even assigning a family to take that. So we've had, you know, where Nathan's sister, I'll say, okay, you have Monday night's dinner. His other sister, you have Tuesday night's dinner. We'll have, you know, we'll all collaborate on Thanksgiving on Thursday. Then, you know, this sister, you take Friday, mom takes, you know, and kind of assigning so that that all of that isn't on us or whoever the host is, having to think about not just the big grand Thanksgiving meal or Christmas meal, but then everything else the other days mm-hmm. that they're around. It's got to be divvied up to some degree, especially when they're in your home. Mm-hmm. And I think it's nice too. I try to, like, when we have company come, I think this is always something that needs to be said on the front end, especially if you're having in-laws coming, or, you know, not your nuclear family, but there's the daughter-in-law or the son-in-law or the even the parents coming, to kind of establish what the ground rules of, like, the house is, you know, like, my refrigerator is open. Please do not ask me if you can get a drink. There are the cups. There are the drinks. If you want to open up the fridge and eat a whole container of blueberries, because that has happened, like, go for it. That's fine. You know, just let us know so that we can replenish it, or have you, you know, have your mother replenish it kind of thing. Like, just that those things are established so that people are feeling comfortable and they're not feeling like, well, I'm really thirsty, but, mm-hmm. you know, I don't know if I should drink tap water or if there's bottled water. And, mm-hmm. you know, my mom, whenever she comes, she doesn't like our tap water, so she wants bottled water. So knowing those things ahead of time, and then being able to say, this is what we do here, have at it, you know, mm-hmm. yeah. casa es su casa. mm-hmm.
And I so love that you brought this up, Jennifer, because it's very true. You really have to pace yourself if you're having people in your home for multiple days. And I'll say, like, if you've got people that are staying for almost a week, everyone needs to be able to have a safe place to go alone. Because inevitably, they'll need that. I've learned that small groups of people, you know, certain people want introvert time, but some people want to go out and work out, or some people want to go play basketball together. Not scheduling everything so much where everyone's, like, busy, but also you can't be around the house that entire mm-hmm. time and all get along. Mm-hmm. Another thing that I've learned just personally is I used to feel like when I was hosting, I had to be present 24/7 and available to serve. I can't do that. I can't keep it up. I'm just not strong enough mm-hmm. mentally. Mm-hmm. With myself, I've learned that it's okay for me to step away for an hour or two mm-hmm. and just going in my room and reading my Kindle and shutting the door. And Bryce will be like, nope, the door's closed. Don't go in there. Mm. Don't ask your mom anything. Mm-hmm. Or I'll go for a walk. Like, I might need to move. If we've done a lot of sitting and laughing and playing, and I'm like, I really need to go work out just for myself. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, I've noticed Bryce and I, it's literally so classic that a couple will start bickering with one another. And Ray, I'm so glad you brought that up. And Jennifer, you brought that up. It happens. Like, this is stressful on your marriage that you're both hosting. And you've got family dynamics coming into play, and you've got sibling dynamics from years ago. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they've all got kids. So you and your spouse maybe need to plan a time, like a quiet morning, or go to get coffee, leave the house together. Maybe mm-hmm. it's okay. mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Like, I'm trying to plan. How can we not bicker and fight and get stressed? And, you know, you want to enjoy that time together because it truly is very special.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk a little bit about other aspects of surviving the holiday season. How do you balance extended family obligations with immediate family obligations?
You know, when we moved here, we quickly learned, okay, let's go crazy on Thanksgiving. Let's go back to Florida. Let's see all the people, see all the family, so that when we return and we enter the Christmas Advent season, we can at least have some margin to remember what we're doing here and why we're even having this season in the first place, and not be crazy. And then it kind of evolved into, you know, my mom wanted to see us and we wanted to see her at Christmas. And so she started coming up. This has probably been 5 or 6 years now. She comes up for a week at Christmas, but we do it early on in the month. And so that happens early on in the month. And I've kind of said to Nathan and our, you know, whoever, I'm happy to have anybody come during the month of December within reason, just not on Christmas Day. Christmas Eve or Christmas Day, I just want it to be the five of us, because I don't want to have to, on Christmas Day and opening presents, be mitigating the dynamics. I don't want to do the dynamics, all the dynamics of personalities and mother-in-law or mother, or, you know, aunt, uncle, cousin, anybody. I just want it to be like we can just relax and be the five of us. And I know that we are not long for that completely to change, where kids are going to start getting married. And then that could go any direction. And I realize that we could love them like our own and it feels just like it always felt, or that could completely not be the case. And so I'm trying to enjoy that for what it is for now, knowing that it won't always look like that, but this is the boundary I have for right now. And then, you know, as soon as we enter that season of kids getting married and there's now other families and dynamics to, like, we'll switch everything up again and realize that how we've always done it, those are the days gone by and they're changed, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. So that's for us. And I've learned, having, you know, my mom come, what she likes to do, what she wants that week to look like. And that's not, it's not a week for her to tag along on my errands. It's a week for, like, that's her best part of Christmas, is to be with us. And so I've learned that that week is not a week that I need to count on having the opportunity to get things done. And so I've learned, you know, I've got to back all up my productivity to prior to that week, which then turns into prior to Thanksgiving. So, you know, it's, but that's what I've learned over the years. The first couple of years, I was taking her on all my errands and her being a part of that. And that wasn't fun, and learning from that. So I think it's really important to have, if you can, if it's possible, good communication. You know, I didn't really see that until my mom said, like, I kind of want to do some fun things. Can we go do some fun things? And me go, oh, you mean you don't like going to Walmart with me and helping me with teacher gifts? Okay, well, you know,
yeah.
So I do think communication is really important, especially, you know, dealing with your own people and knowing what they want the holidays to look like, but then also the extended people, for sure. I see that on my horizon.
I love that we're answering this question in the season that we're in, because this is so true. And I love that you started, Jennifer, because I remember, like, being in that season, and when it was just Abby when she left and in college still, and then Grant when he left and in college still, like, we had that, those were the seasons where I could plan with the six of us still. Mm-hmm. And ironically, then when Abby got married, we held gifts 1 year, like our transition Christmas. I'm going to call it our transition Christmas because I realized this was not going to work for us anymore. Mm. And that was the year that my younger two let me know. Mm-hmm. They did not appreciate us waiting to have Christmas until Abby and Joey could be at our house, because they had other priorities that they had to handle before they came to our house. So we literally held Christmas until like the 26th or 27th. Mm. My two totally said no more. Mm-hmm. We need Christmas on Christmas. And I was like, okay, I need to let it go. And that was another just hard letting go season, is that, and Abby and Joey understood, but they're starting their own family.
Right.
They don't have kids yet. So I'm glad Marie's going after me, because I know this is going to change again. Mm-hmm. But right now, like, I have learned, Christmas is on Christmas, no matter who's here. Mm-hmm. It's on the 25th. So and I told Abby and Joey when they got married, I said, I don't want you guys to feel stressed or pressured to be at my house on those big high pressure days of Thanksgiving and Christmas. I will not have a power struggle with Joey's family. I do not want you guys to feel like you're in a power struggle between our family and their family, because we've got three more spouses that we're going to eventually add to our home. I can't put that on my kids. I just want you to come when you can come, and let's have fun when you're here. Those are my two things. Mm-hmm. But yeah, Christmas is on Christmas now.
Yeah. Right. And for listeners that have situations like Mindy and I, where you have some older kids and then some younger kids, there's a unique dynamic of pressure that I have felt since my daughter got married in 2017. Every single one of those Christmases, I have felt the pressure to still make Christmas the way it's always been for the younger kids. But
right.
The older kids are kind of moving on in the way they want to celebrate Christmas. But I'm like, but wait, you know, I mean, my girls were only like 14 when my daughter got married. They're not ready to just give up Christmas morning with their siblings. Like, they were depressed by the Christmas Eve that we spent with just the three younger ones and their mom and dad. Like, they want those older siblings yep. there too. So like, there's this pressure that I've got to make Christmas the way it's always been, but I don't want to alienate the new spouses, but I'm still want to try and make Christmas for these other kids. Now that they are in college and, you know, one is 21 and two are 19, I feel like, all right, we may have crawled across the finish line, but we did reach the finish line. Like, you've had your childhood Christmases as best as I could do it. And now they might look a little different going forward.
It's so funny you say that, because I mentioned our charming little Christmas gift situation that we do of the something you want, something you need. Yeah. And I have been pondering for a couple of years now, how do I phase that out? Because I'm not doing that forever, but I don't want to phase it out when Kate hits the appropriate age, but I don't want to phase it out for the youngers because Kate got more years of it. It's so funny because I think about that constantly, of all these sweet little traditions that I know aren't going to last because those were kid things, mm-hmm. but not wanting to just throw all three of them out, because then that means Thad, our youngest, didn't get as many years with the XYZ tradition.
All right. Well, we've talked about a lot, but I feel like we would be remiss if we didn't just address what we talked about kind of at the beginning, how we know we will all feel kind of burned out in January. But how can we lessen that? I don't want to put out there, like, how can we avoid holiday burnout? Because every single listener is old enough to know that you're going to be burned out. But how can we lessen holiday burnout and really take it all in?
I think for me, and it's something I've just had to learn over the years, and I'm sure your audience is probably in the same stage of life and would agree to all of this, but first is planning. I think I've just learned, it's taken me probably 10 years to figure this out, but like, once Halloween kind of rolls around, I'm already a little bit late. I need to kind of start that process of just mulling on Christmas a little bit earlier in the fall. And so I think just whatever it is that you want to get done, to kind of just map that out and start, whether it's gifts or whether it's what you put in stockings or whether it's how you handle gifts or shopping for extended family, or even just getting on, how are we doing extended family presents? Is it everybody draws a name? Are we doing a family gift? Just starting that process of mulling on it early, you know, and getting that ball rolling. And then, you know, I just think that once you're in it and living what you have been planning and pondering on, once you start to execute and live in it, like, you got to chill out and realize that one, you know, dashed expectation, like, don't believe the lie that now Christmas has failed. If one thing failed or multiple things failed, that all of it is, you can chalk it up to experience and a lesson learned for the following year. And I think for dealing with people and extended family as well, that it's really important that we set boundaries and we know how to do that and what those look like for us. And those come with learned experience every year. But, you know, I mean, maybe, like, this is backing it way up in advance, maybe we should all go get counseling so that we really understand what good boundaries are. I'm just kidding on that, but maybe not. but that's where I learned how to set good boundaries and how I'm able to say no to certain things. And, you know, for anybody that's a people pleaser, it's really important to be able to say, no, I'm not going to do that. Or no, we're not going to go there. Or no, you know, I'm going to say no to all of these things to please all of the people. That you just got to learn that power of no, I think, and mm-hmm. and being able to set healthy boundaries with yourself, with your schedule, with your rest, and then with the people that you're having to please and entertain and host and shop for and thank and all the things, the boundaries, the healthy boundaries. Mm-hmm. Right. And then I know, just having learned about boundaries when I was in my early 20s, you know, and this could be its own podcast episode, but once you get empowered and start to set them, the pendulum goes as far extreme in the other direction, and then it has to learn how to fall back. So you might think, I'm going to set boundaries so well this year, I'm going to do it. And it's likely it'll be too much and you will hurt some people's feelings. And then hopefully there's a lot of grace, because that pendulum will swing back to the middle and you'll learn what actually is a healthy boundary.
Mm-hmm. Right. Oh my goodness. I love this conversation so much. And I'll say, just a personal testimony from all that our holidays have looked like through all of the years. We've had a lot of moves. And for me, part of the major stress has been having Christmas in a new home every couple of years and then hosting in a new home every couple of years. I feel like I could write a book about this because it happened over and over and over and over. And this is one of my first years in 5 years where it will be our third Christmas in the same home, in the same place, with the same furniture, the same people are coming. And so through all of that, I think one of the big, big stressors in my life, but also one of the healthiest revelations for me is to have no expectations.
Right.
I'm not going to say low expectations. I'm saying no expectations. It has chilled me out to the point where I can say, I just need everybody to show up at some point and have a good time. Because that, if I can just put it in a nutshell, like that's my heart. I've had to let go of all of the preferences, all of the preferences. And I'm even flexible about who comes and when and how long. And I'm just like, they're coming. I don't know when they're coming. They'll let me know when they're on their way, you know? And my whole house might have to flip to accommodate. So, anyways, no expectations. I'm so joyful going into this year because I'm not purchasing any new Christmas decorations. I'm not worried about that my house has all of the Christmas decorations out. I'm going to accommodate all the seating. I'm going to make my house work for the people that will be here for however long they decide to stay. And I'm going to make sure that I'm able to just enjoy the people.
Yeah,
I agree with that. Just having low expectations and a low bar, you know, just kind of bare minimum. And it's funny because when we talk about like just expectations and, you know, of the holidays, this one story always pops in my head. So it was, I don't know, 7 or 8 years ago. So maybe my oldest was 9 or 10. I think it was Christmas of 2016 is what I'm thinking. And we always would go, since we had moved to Tennessee, to a friend's house for Christmas Eve, like after Christmas Eve service for the Christmas Eve night. Well, this particular year, the wife of the family that we were spending Christmas Eve with had been diagnosed with cancer, and it was terminal. And we knew that this was probably her last Christmas heading. And so I felt very high pressure, just that this was the last Christmas Eve, you know, that time she would have. And it just, there was a lot of pressure weighing on it. And so we gave our kids the full, you know, expectation list as we're pulling into their home. And that night, wouldn't you know, they were awful. They were running and screaming. And I mean, it's just normal kids, which this family is so very fine with. And there were other kids there. But there was one point of the evening where one of my kids had locked themselves in the bathroom and the other two were banging on the door, kicking the door. And it was just this scene out of like National Lampoon's like Christmas movie. I was mortified thinking, you have ruined this woman's Christmas. I mean, Nathan and I were so mad. And we got in the car, like we apologized, we left, we got in the car and we were like, we have to address this tonight or we will resent them tomorrow morning. We were ready to take away all their presents, throw them in the trash. I mean, it was like everything about the holiday had, I mean, it was blown up in our head now, even repeating it back, but we just were mortified and we went home and we swiftly addressed that in all the ways that we did our discipline. I don't know if I can talk about that on here, but we addressed it. And it was just this like reality of it's not always going to go how you hope and how you picture. And you've got to let, you know, the expectations go. And when it does fail, when it does go south and wrong and grossly wrong, and that felt like a very grossly wrong because it was, you know, of the circumstances surrounding it, that it is what it is. And you've just got to realize, well, that's not how I wanted that to go. And we're going to do what we can the next time. But that was just a wild time that particular year. I felt terrible.
Yeah, that is a good story to kind of end our talk on, Jennifer, because We will have those moments. We have had those moments. Every mom can relate to how you felt when you got in that car. Like, we yes. all know. And we all have had the letdown of a Christmas expectation or whatever. So, listeners, we are with you in solidarity. We are trying to stay sane during the holidays, just like you are, and also embracing and taking it all in. And mm-hmm. we do love the holidays, and we do love having our family home.
Mm-hmm. Right. That's right.
Listeners, we would love to hear from you on this subject. You can find us on Instagram at Midlife Matters Podcast, or you can email us at midlifematterspodcast@gmail.com. But before we go, we want to do I'm a Fan. And Mindy, what are you a fan of this week?
I'm a huge fan of a movie. I will say the movie is actually not that great, but...
Okay.
but I hosted the best girl party to have a watch party for it because it was the movie that was filmed in LaGrange, Georgia. And I was hoping to see myself as an extra in it because a year ago, two friends and I went downtown to be an extra in the Christmas movie that was filming. And you cannot see us one iota. So don't hopes up. But it's such a fun movie. It's on Freevee. It's called The Perfect Christmas Pairing. And it was filmed between our downtown location in LaGrange and also Nutwood Winery that's in LaGrange. And it just is super fun because a bunch of girls got together. We all brought food. We all wore our Christmas jammies. And we watched the movie. And we are able to see like friends and neighbors and different people in town that are extras in the movie.
Oh, I love that. I love that.
That's fun.
We are definitely going to have to link to that in our show notes. And I don't ever watch Hallmark movies, but I will tune in for that one, Mindy. If I have that, you said it's on Freevee?
Freevee, which is on Prime, I believe. I think it's through Prime is where it's on. But yeah, it's so beautiful. And that is my precious little town. So I'm just really proud of it, even though we totally sat there and made fun of the guy's hair the entire time. But that's what
that's probably why they cut you out.
Me.
Okay. All right, Jennifer, what are you afraid of? Or what are you afraid of? Jennifer, what are you... I'm thinking about the holidays. Jennifer, what are you a fan of this week?
A fan of. I'm not afraid of this. So one thing when I was thinking about this has kind of become a bit of a tradition, and I don't even want to call it a tradition because when it doesn't happen one year, I don't want to be sad about it. But for somehow it evolved very naturally. Whenever the holidays happen and we're all just kind of home and it's cold and it's dark, we started bringing out puzzles. And we don't do puzzles at any point during the year, but it evolved into a Christmas. And so now it has kind of become a little thing that there's always a puzzle that needs to be worked on our table. And I found this company, the website is mosaicpuzzles.co, I guess. And it's these puzzles, they're wooden. So they're a little bit more expensive. They're wooden, but each piece of the puzzle is something like a butterfly or a dinosaur or a person or a it's really cool, like a bear, a spider, you know. I'll hold the picture up and you can kind of see the little pieces, but so you're each individual piece is an actual little item, and then you put it together to make the big puzzle. And so my son likes to do puzzles the most with me. My husband and the girls don't like it as much, and so that's kind of been something that he and I do together. And so I got that for him for Christmas. And we're going to work on that over the holidays.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, because one of the reasons I don't really like working on puzzles, like the multi-pieced ones, is I don't get the satisfaction when I put in a piece of even seeing something. It's like, oh, well, there were 5 leaves on that. And it wasn't the piece that completed the tree. It's just another leaf. But this sounds like it would be more rewarding.
I guess. They were saying even the way it's... like, I guess, created because of the wood, that it's wood. When it snaps into piece, it literally says on the website, the satisfaction of hearing it snap into piece.
So that would be satisfying.
I'm excited to try it out because we just have regular cardboard puzzles, and this one is just different.
Wow.
All right. Well, I'm a fan of an easy recipe to host a lot of people. I've already done it twice, I think. in the month of October. I don't think I did it three times. But basically, you've probably done this before. You may have heard of this before, but it's so easy. You get fresh chicken breasts. I really even do think you could use frozen, but I used fresh chicken breasts, filled my crock pot with them. Put in, depending on how many chicken breasts you're using, you can either put in one pack or two packs of taco seasoning and one or two jars of salsa, and then just let that thing cook in your crock pot all day. And I made a big crock pot full of it, and I think I served probably like, I bet you could serve 20 people with that. I mean, it really goes far. You end up shredding it. You can put out soft tortillas. You can put out, you know, chips to go with it, guacamole, like all the things. But your meat is, I don't know, it always feels like the meat is the hardest thing to make and keep hot. And that's already made like at noon when you put it on for the day, and then you're just shredding it.
That's great. And I think like 99% of people love Mexican foods.
Absolutely. Great idea.
Good.
So anyways, well, thank you guys for talking about holiday burnout. This was a great topic. I know that the next month is going to be really busy, and hopefully we will remember the things that we talked about today and not feel quite as burned out in January.
Here's hoping.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. We'll talk to you guys later.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye. We're so happy you joined us today. You can find the show notes for this episode at midlifematterspodcast.com. Also, please tell a friend about the show and help them hit the free subscribe button on their favorite podcast app. Be sure to follow us on Instagram at Midlife Matters Podcast. That's where we post pictures and stories about all the things we talk about in each episode. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next week.